Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand,
Please stand.
Appear the hour I first.
Our liturgy and prayer responses are printed for you on the manila folder. Please respond in the parts in bold. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from death through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. All of you who were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. We pray. Jesus, our confidence is in you. Even in the midst of our sorrow, we know your love never fails. Grant us the grace to see that nothing can sever us from you and your love. During our times of grief and loss, we turn to God's holy word as our source of comfort and peace. A reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. This is the word of our Lord. A reading from 1 Peter chapter 1. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, that your faith may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of our Lord. A reading from John chapter 14, Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This is the gospel of our Lord. The reading of the life story. John Kinberg was a wonderful person to know and to love, a man of many special interests, yet it was evident in every way that his family meant the world to him. A longtime steward to the community he loved, his genuine and good-natured ways, as well as his incredible wisdom and support, will forever be remembered by his many special friends and loved ones. The 1940s were characterized by World War II. By 1947, some of the most significant inventions that would impact lives for many years to come were created, including the transistor and the mobile phone. That same year, John Norman was born to Norman and Janet Kinneberg on August 25th in La Crosse, Wisconsin. His birth brought his parents and family great joy. Growing up south of rural Rushford, John learned the value of a hard day's work at an early age. He enjoyed working on the family farm where he was raised by his Aunt Hilda and Uncle Selmer. He fell in love with livestock and enjoyed many years as an active member of 4-H, Ferndale Ramblers, and FFA. John had a special interest in polled Herefords and proudly showed them at local and state fairs as well as at junior livestock shows. He enjoyed farming his land and especially relished picking a bumper crop of corn. In addition to his hard work on the farm, John managed to excel in his studies as well as played both football and basketball for Rushford High School, where he graduated with the class of 1965. With a strong passion for farming, John pursued a Bachelor of Science degree in animal science, starting out at Winona State University, before later transferring to the University of Minnesota, St. Paul, where he graduated in 1972. Not to be forgotten was the meeting of Joan Cahoon, his high school sweetheart. They joined in marriage on December 30th, 1967 at Rushford Lutheran Church. Their lives gained momentum in 1968 when he and Joan took over the Kinneberg Polled Hereford Farm and welcomed home their firstborn son, Dean. John's breeding business became very successful early on in his career. Proud of his grand champion bulls and heifers, he enjoyed traveling out west to purchase cattle as well as ski and sightsee. In 1971, they welcomed home their daughter, Jody. She soon became his sidekick on the farm and his little tomboy. His early signs of involvement with his community were during this time when he proudly served 6 years for the Rushford School Board starting in 1972. John and Joan suffered the unbearable pain of their loss of Dean in 1974. Through the grief and devastation, John and Joan found strength in their faith. In 1975, Jared was born. He soon became John's little hotshot. John's farming career was prospering, and he earned himself the title of Outstanding Young Cattleman of Minnesota in 1976. Never one to remain idle, with John's interest in aviation, he also pursued his pilot's license in 1978, a pastime he shared with his family for years. He shared his first solo flight with Jared on his third birthday. Their youngest son, Jed, completed their family by his arrival in 1980. Jed was John's little pride and joy. Later, John and Joan's marriage ended in divorce, yet they remained friends as they raised their family. John was a proud father. He found joy in being involved in his children's activities and adult lives. He was always there to listen, give advice, and lend a helping hand. John was a man of many special interests. In his younger years, he enjoyed skiing, snowmobiling, and playing golf. He also loved to participate in the Minnesota State Fair and other cattle shows. He loved deer and turkey hunting with his sons, son-in-law Brent, daughter-in-law Melissa, and grandson Hayden, as well as his loyal group of hunting buddies. In his second career, John worked in the fertilizer department and managed the feed mill at the Farmers Co-op Elevator in Rushford for a remarkable 25 years. He enjoyed supporting the county fair 4-H livestock auctions on behalf of the elevator before he retired in 2009. Later in life, John became an avid wildlife photographer. He also enjoyed gardening and getting together with the regulars for coffee at Stumpy's. John lived his life to the fullest. When I was at the house, I noticed all the pictures on the wall of the animals, and I thought, wow, this is just some incredible photography here. And I asked him, do you only shoot with a camera? And he says, no, I like to shoot them too. A family man, John was blessed with his role as a grandfather. He relished in the years he took them to local playgrounds, air shows, zoos, circuses, bull riding, fishing, and a game of bat and ball in the backyard. A sports fan for many years, John enjoyed cheering on the local high school teams, as well as the Vikings, Twins, and Gophers. Yet he was the biggest fan of his own grandchildren. He cherished any time he was able to see them in action on the football, baseball, soccer, or softball fields, as well as the hockey rink, volleyball court, and dance floor. John was immensely proud of each and every one of them. A simple and humble man, there wasn't anything he wouldn't do to help a friend or neighbor in need. May his wonderful gifts of generosity and kindness be forever etched on the hearts and minds of all who knew and loved him, and may his memories be eternal. John Norman Kinnenberg, age 73, of Rushford, Minnesota, died peacefully Sunday, January 17th, 2021, at Gunderson Health Systems in La Crosse, Wisconsin, with family by his side. John fought a courageous battle against several cancers over the last 7 years, including esophageal cancer and acute myeloid leukemia after a recent diagnosis. Active throughout his life, he was a member of Rushford JCs, Rushford Lions Club, Fillmore County Cattlemen's Association, Minnesota Polled Hereford Association, Minnesota Iowa Wisconsin Hereford Association. John is survived by his children, Jody and Brent Hoynes, Jared and Jennifer Kinnenberg, Jed and Melissa Kinnenberg, grandchildren Hayden, Hillary, and Haley Hoynes, Cooper, Bennett, and Dawson Kinnenberg, Jalissa and Charlie Kinnenberg, former wife Joan, siblings Norris Kinnenberg, Sharon Boyum, Verdale Kinnenberg, brother-in-law Milt Knutson, and several nieces and nephews. John is preceded in death by his son, Dean Marcus, his parents, and sister, Janice Knutson. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Melissa would like to share with us now a special song called Daddy's Hands.
Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to wonder.
Dear Jody, Jared, and Jed family and friends, a week ago last Thursday, I shared some words from Scripture with John and family. I share with them, with you once again, Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In Jesus' name, amen. For the past few months, I sense John reaching out to Jesus more and more. And given all the restrictions, both pandemic and with his own health, that wasn't as easy as it should have been. At first, John wanted to come into my office for communion, and he was able to do that, but eventually that didn't really work out, so I went to his home. Two Thursdays ago, we talked about his latest diagnosis. I asked him straight up if he was going to try to fight the good fight one more time. Of course he would. Not even a question. Hardworking and proud, two of the words that you use to describe your father. There was never a battle that John would run away from. But no one knew, including the doctors apparently, no one knew just how bad things were going deep inside his body. A body that had not really recovered from the last time, the last disease, the last cancer. And John was reaching out to Jesus, and Jesus was reaching out to him. "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Yes, that is what has happened. For this man who couldn't stop working, this man who couldn't stop fighting the good fight, this man who had battled various types of cancer through the years, so why would this one be any different? He had won so many times, we thought, but it was. "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me," Jesus says. A yoke. We don't see those too often anymore, do we? A yoke is like a collar, but it's actually a collar for an ox. This big beast of burden would have a large bar of wood strapped to its neck, on each side a metal ring with a rope, the ropes going back to the driver to guide the ox to the right or to the left. Whole teams of oxen could be yoked together. And John was at heart a farmer. And even though he may never have actually farmed with oxen, I don't think so, he knew the concept. He knew the burden it was to wear a yoke, to have that heavy burden of wood placed on your shoulders and neck, to be tied to an owner and guided by them. "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me," Jesus says. This passage from Matthew is beautifully worded passage, but honestly, not that clear or easy to understand. Especially when Jesus says, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." No yoke is easy. No yoke is light. Jesus and his listeners knew that, as did John, as was the daily yoke he bore. "Learn from me," Jesus says. Learn from me. A common misconception many Christians have about eternal salvation, about what comes next after we die, is that a Christian is judged by how well they did with the burdens they bore in life. If they did well with the life that they were given, if they handled those burdens well, then eternal rewards await them in heaven. However, if they didn't do so well with those burdens, well, you know, it just doesn't go that well in the end. But that, my friends, that is not Christianity. That is Eastern thought. Indeed, that is not salvation by grace. That is karma, We sow what we reap. We get what we deserve. But learn from me, Jesus says. Learn from me and keep our eyes on Jesus. Then what is Christianity? Christianity is the great exchange. Our heavy yoke for his light yoke for ours. Our burdens in exchange for his blessings. Because of God's love for us, Christ gets what we deserve, and in exchange, we get what he has earned. Christ takes upon himself our burdens, our sins, the heaviness of life that we all live under each day. Jesus takes our yoke upon his shoulders, and in exchange, gives us his. And the yoke that we give to him, unfortunately, is shaped like a cross. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light, Jesus says. Think for a moment of all the heavy burdens John bore through his life. His very difficult early life, living with extended family, farming, which has never been easy, marriage and raising kids, and perhaps the greatest of these, losing one of them, losing Dean. Throughout his life, John's yoke had become not just a burden, but a breaking point. But in the end, that is, in the last few months of his life, John was reaching out to Jesus more and more. And from him, from both Jesus and John, maybe you and I have a lesson to learn. Because a second misconception, a second misunderstanding that is rampant in Christianity today is a bit of bumper sticker, kitchen coffee mug theology. The idea that God never gives us more than we can handle. And this idea that God never gives us more than we can handle is largely based on a misunderstanding of Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Simply put, because the sentence begins with I, we also begin to think it really is about me. But note what it actually says. I can do all things through him, through God who strengthens me. Without God, without him, life always is and always will be more than we can handle. And that includes John's life, and yours is mine as well. And we see the same scenario over and over again in the Bible. People who are burdened beyond what they know what to do with, the blind, the lame, the demon-possessed, the woman caught in adultery, Jairus and his dead daughter, and whether the burden is of their own making or a yoke God has placed upon them, the same purpose for that burden applies. To force us out of ourselves, to force us to the foot of the cross, to force us to our knees in front of Jesus, to reach out to Jesus. Friends, are you willing to take your crowns and lay them at the feet of Jesus? When will you realize that life for God, or whatever you want to call it, it always gives us more than we can handle? And it's time for Jesus to carry the load. Are you at that point where you are willing to lay down your burdens in exchange for his blessings? For my yoke is easy and my burden is light, Jesus says. Tomorrow I will be preaching on one of my favorite Bible characters, the drowning fisherman. Now, you don't know the story about that title, but I believe that it's apt. The story of Peter walking on water, better titled, The Drowning Fisherman. Here it is from Matthew 14:25-32. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid." Take heart. "It is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And throughout Peter's life, his life with Jesus, Jesus constantly gave Peter more than he could handle. Over and over, Jesus piled on Peter responsibilities, trials, and tests. For what purpose? So that Peter would fail. Yes, fail. So that the strong, proud, and hard-headed fisherman would fail, would drown. But even more so, so that Peter would cry out to Jesus. So that Peter would eventually realize that the yoke he bore was more than he could bear. So that Peter would one day reach out to Jesus. In the past few months, I sensed John reaching out to Jesus more and more. John was a strong man, a proud man, a man who was used to fighting back. But in the end, that yoke that he wore was simply too much to bear. "Lord, save me." Peter reached out. He reached out to Jesus, and Jesus reached back and saved him. Just like last Sunday, Jesus reached out to his servant, John. Matthew 11, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In Jesus' name, amen.
Or in awe of you be still.
To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees? I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
On behalf of my family, I want to thank you all for coming today to honor our dad. He would be humbled by us all gathered together here today to celebrate his life. Our dad achieved much in his lifetime, especially in his early years. I am in awe of him when I reflect on his early adult life and all he accomplished. Dad had two very successful careers, a growing family, and has served the community he so loved. Dad was a man of integrity. Through your words and your actions, you have taught us so much about life, Dad. You have taught us the importance of honesty and to be kind and humble, the importance of education, and to achieve goals, you have to work hard. What truly matters has no monetary value. To be strong, confident, and to always believe in ourselves, how to overcome adversity, to learn where we come from, and know our family history. It is because of you, Dad, I'm a tiny bit tomboy. I love farm animals, horses, the country, and sports. We all three love nature and being outdoors. Jared loves aviation because of you and finds flying his drone his happy place. Jed is a skilled handyman, a hunter, and a bit of a farmer at heart because of you. Because of you, we have sweet memories of horseback riding, whisker rubs before bed, driving at too young of an age, flying, learning to shoot guns and bows, and hunting together. Yes, I even went hunting once. Checking cows, early calves being brought in the house to warm up, and doing chores. Snowmobiling, sledding, attending Viking, Twins, and Gopher games together. Sitting in the bleachers with me in nail-biting hockey and baseball games and celebrating the big play and the win with you. And mostly, as of late, just hanging out in Jed's garage. Not only a great dad, but a loving and accepting father-in-law. He thought of Brent, Jen, and Mel as his own children. Dad was a wonderful grandpa. He was happiest when he was with his family, and his greatest joys in life were his 8 grandchildren. He enjoyed just being with them, to play, talk, celebrate milestones, cheering in the stands, and keeping up with what and how everyone was doing in school and their activities. He was a very proud papa. As many of you know, he was proud to share updates and successes of his grandkids. He didn't have to say he was proud. We just knew by the questions he asked, the excitement in his voice, and the joy on his face when he spent time with us. To our children, each of you have given Grandpa so much joy in your own unique way. Keep Grandpa proud. Work hard and stay humble and kind in his honor as you continue your life's journey. Dad had a strong presence that to some he may have seemed a bit intimidating. I know this, as he got my attention when he needed to. But he was mostly gentle and kind. He was sweet, helpful, and generous. He would drop whatever he was doing to help any of us with a project. I could call him up and tell him anything, and I knew he would never judge me. He would just listen and only offer advice if he was asked. I will miss my dad's comforting presence every day, and I am so grateful for the many years I had with him. Dad, I will think of you when I start my morning with a strong cup of black coffee, when I enjoy a chocolate shake on a hot summer day, when a small airplane flies overhead, when I see a combine out in the field, when I wear maroon, when I see a lutefisk supper advertised, sorry, I won't be attending, and when I tend to my flowers in the summer. There are many things that will remind me of you daily. You will always be on my mind and in my heart. It was 7.5 years ago, Dad was diagnosed with esophageal cancer. He faced it head on and he beat it. Since then, he had a few reoccurrences and was very persistent in his fight. While he was unable to beat his most recent diagnosis of leukemia, he was strong and courageous until the end. Through this journey with Dad, he has taught me to overcome my paralyzing fears, to be strong, and to rely on my faith. People often say how they wish they'll pass on. I believe Dad got his wish. He had his family by his side around the clock during his last week of life, caring for him, FaceTime calls to grandkids, stories told of sweet memories. There was laughter and tears, several embracing moments, and moments of just being still in the quiet while holding hands. But most important, his final days were full of the love of family. I believe he was right with God. He told us he loved us, and he was ready to end his courageous fight. Dad took his final flight home peacefully with his family by his side. Dad, it has been a privilege to be your daughter. We are all better for knowing you. Dad, I will miss you terribly, but I am profoundly honored to forever be your little girl. I love you, Dad. Now, if my family would please rise and join me in prayer that our dad and mom taught us many years ago. Now, I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Amen. Would the congregation please rise and say the Lord's Prayer with me? I believe it's printed in your bulletin. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We continue with our prayers printed in our folder. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have called your chosen people together into one holy body. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Grant that all who have been called into your kingdom by baptism into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the gate of death and the grave we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Give to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to continue to listen to your calling and follow you. The family would like to extend their thanks for the many flowers, memorials, and other acts of kindness that have been demonstrated to them at this time. Now, unfortunately, due to COVID restrictions, we are not able to offer space for the typical fellowship luncheon. But as you depart today, the family will be greeting you on the way out through that doorway. They also invite you to join with them at the committal service at Highland Prairie Cemetery. We will be processing to the cemetery together in our vehicles after the family has finished greeting everyone that is present. We will also be parking in the church parking lot at Highland Prairie and walking down to the burial site. We pray. God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to call us to faith and to give us new life. We give you thanks that by his death, he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because Jesus lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, John Kinneberg. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
Guard you.
Jesus.